Good morning, everybody. How are you guys doing today? My name is Jenny Huolroyd, and I am the manager for the Occupational Health Group at the Georgia Tech Research Institute. I have two of my colleagues with me, Hillary Warren in the back and Art Wickman, and an additional third industrial hygienist in training, Owen, who is at 3 months old, already being trained on the hazard communication of silica exposure. So this is very important, and we must be respectful of his learning environment. But if he does start fussing, we will take care of that, and everything will be lovely. And Hillary is coming back from maternity leave, and Art is here. They are both here because the goal of this lunch and learn is for us to provide you with the information and tool set you need to start grappling with compliance with the silica standard. And it is a huge standard to begin complying with. But also we want to know what your questions are and your challenges and your concerns that you foresee with compliance with the standard. What we are in the process of doing right now, and Hillary and Art and I are working together on creating, is a course related to getting everybody in compliance with the silica standard. And we want what we deliver for you guys to be the most useful course that is possible. So this is a fact-finding mission for us as much as it is a training lesson for you guys. I provided you with four different handouts. The handouts include a copy of the standard for the construction industry. Primarily, I gave you a copy of it because of Table 1, which is the most important part of the standard for all of you. And I'll go into why that's so important. We also have a list of the silica courses that are already on the book for us to offer. And I'll go into why it will be so important that there is someone that comes in attendance of the course because of the new requirements with the standard. And I created a checklist, which does have some errors that we're gonna have to correct, but it is the beginning of a document for you guys to use sort of as a roadmap to find your way to compliance. We've been talking with lots of contractors, subcontractors, and other companies, and we've been listening to the challenges that they are facing already in trying to reach compliance. So we're trying to give you a step-by-step to-do list and be able to check those boxes on how you're going to comply with the standard. And the final document is a list of our free seminars. We always want to share information about free classes, so you can't go wrong with a free seminar. So the new rule for the silica standard reduces the amount of respirable crystalline silica that employees can be exposed to tremendously. It dropped to 50 micrograms per cubic meter for the permissible exposure limit, and because this is a substance-specific standard, there is also an action level, and the action level is 25 micrograms per cubic meter. This is important because it means you're going to have to start doing a lot of things when you hit that action level if you're required to do sampling. The standard does require exposure determination and evaluation. However, for the construction industry, they created what we will continually reference as Table 1, which is an alternative to doing exposure monitoring. And for what it's worth, you want to be on Table 1, because Table 1 relieves you of having to do air monitoring, and air monitoring is expensive and labor intensive. So we want to keep you on Table 1 as much as possible and from going on to the exposure monitoring. And to provide a little bit of perspective, so that is a penny up there, and that little speck of dust next to it is the amount of silica that would get you at the permissible exposure limit, or to the full shift to be over the permissible exposure limit. So it's, when we're talking about 50 micrograms per cubic meter, it is a very small amount of dust. Just kind of give you perspective. And whenever they make substance-specific standards. I do want you to keep in mind that there were recommendations to actually lower the PEL 2.25 micrograms per cubic meter. And they conceded to the 50 micrograms per cubic meter or the 0.5 milligrams per cubic meter. What that means is there is scientific documentation that exposure to crystalline silica below the PEL still potentially could do harm to employees. And I want to reemphasize the point that anytime with industrial hygiene and with substance-specific standards, when we give you a level that you can't exceed, that is just a regulatory limit. It doesn't necessarily mean you're safe or not safe. So that is one thing to keep in mind when you're looking at how to make these controls, is they're telling you to control, but that doesn't necessarily protect your employees to the full extent. So the main reason why we're here and giving you the heads up is because for the first time, a health standard has a requirement to have a competent person. This is tremendous because unlike any other substance-specific standard, we now have to have this equivalent of a competent person. And if you read the preamble, or if you have trouble sleeping at night and read the preamble, because it's over 1,000 pages long, and then they have chapters that didn't get printed in the preamble that I've been reading now, that you can go back to, which are even longer and more in depth. But they do specify that they expect that for a company of fewer than 20 employees, you'd have at least one competent person. For a company between 220 and 499 employees, you'd have at least five competent people. And that anytime you get over 500 employees, you'd have at least 10 competent people on staff. Well, we'll get into the specifics of that. So that's their roundabout on how many competent people you need. However, if you look at the definition for a competent person, they need to be capable of identifying existing and foreseeable silica hazards and have the authorization to make corrective measures, but they also have to make frequent and regular inspections of job sites. So given the complexity of some of your contractor organizations, you may end up needing many more people trained as competent people because of the inability for that competent person to be in multiple places at the same time. That said, in the preamble also is where you find this information, but the recommendation is that employees that are designated as competent people receive at a minimum 3 hours of training. And that 3 hours of training includes at least 1 hour on the hazards of exposure to silica and 2 additional hours of training on the compliance with the standard. We have been testing out training people on the standard, and it's going to take more than 2 hours, just FYI. So what we have put on the books are several full-day silica training classes. We are not calling them competent person classes, and the reason why we're not calling them competent person classes is because part of being a competent person is you being familiar with the hazards on your own job site. So that is part of the designation as a competent person. So you can come to our training, be trained, and then come back and your employer can designate you as a competent person because you're aware of how to apply the knowledge that you've gained in the training. Anybody that sells you on an idea that you can get competent trained in this complex of a topic just by attending a training session alone, that would not be accurate. You can also train your employees to become competent persons as well. So if you need additional people, once you've had adequate training, there is a part in the preamble that says they expect supervisors to end up doing some training of the making people into competent persons for their jobs. So it's not like you have to send everybody to classes, though we would like that, obviously, but we are going to empower you with the resources you need to keep spreading the knowledge on how to comply with the standard. One of those tricky things that you're going to have to come up with as part of the standard is that you're going to have to develop a written exposure control plan. And this written exposure control plan is going to be your crib sheet of all of the potential tasks that could create exposure to silica, crystalline silica, on the jobs. You can imagine that for your companies, we envision it being a pretty complex issue because you're going to probably end up having to make different detailed lists for every job that you're doing. There will be certain tasks that'll be consistent for job to job, but can anyone guess why it might be different from job to job? What are some of the challenges you might face? Hillary in the back, what are some of the challenges you might face? Correct.
You have water available, some sites you don't. Sometimes you've got vacuum assisted tools available, sometimes they're not available, or they don't have power to run those pieces of equipment, or they break, or you're in a different part of the country, and the amount of quartz silica in the ground that you're working with is different than you found in one location.
So that is a really important point. Crystalline silica, the silica that's dangerous, is in different percentages in the ground in different areas of the country. So some areas of the country, you will actually have higher exposures inherently because of the bedrock you're working with than in other areas of the country. And that is why when we say you have to comply with this standard and you want to be on table one. Table one, when we go through it, is going to tell you exactly what you have to do. For better or for worse, it's going to tell you what you have to do, but then you don't have to go and try to figure out what you're going to do. And it'll tell you what you're going to do to comply. In addition to creating those task lists, you have to list out the engineering controls, the work practices, and the respiratory protection used to limit the exposure. So one of the items that we're working on for the course is to create a spreadsheet for you guys to be entering in all this data. So because in the silica standard, unlike any other standard, one of the ways that you determine whether or not you have to be doing medical surveillance is not to do with whether or not you're exceeding the limit, the OSHA permissible exposure limit or the action level. But this time it has to do with how many days a year you're going to be wearing a respirator. So that is a unique change in the interpretation of the law that is going to be part of your planning. You have to figure out how many days employees are going to be exposed. The housekeeping measures are strict, and we're going to go into them, but you're going to have to, I should have brought my chill pills. We have a jar that says chill pills because you're going to need them after you figure out what the housekeeping rules are. They're strict. And then procedures to restrict access to the work area. It is not going to be a classic one like when you're working with lead. It is completely roped off per se. It is going to allow people to go through those areas, but you have to be able to restrict the access. So it is a different interpretation than other standards. And then that standard has to be, that exposure control plan needs to be reviewed annually. Okay. This exposure control plan, this little asterisk table down in the bottom, I should have made a bigger font, assumes that for every job site, you're going to be doing 15-minute job site briefings for the employees about compliance with the standard. So you're going to have to be checking with them to make sure that they are complying with all the standard elements. So if you pull out the standard that you have, that I printed you, and you flip to table three, is the beginning of what we will, page three, is the beginning of table one. And table one is basically going to be what you want to be working from, because it tells you exactly what to do, It tells you exactly the engineering controls you need. It tells you exactly what respiratory protection they require. And it does not require you to do air monitoring as long as you do the what is said in that box. Okay, so there are 18 common tasks that OSHA decided to include, and OSHA has detailed very specific action items to take to protect the employees. It is time dependent. For the most part, they have chosen either less than 4 hours a day or greater than 4 hours a day for the marker. And then all listed controls must be fully and properly implemented in order to use the exemptions offered by compliance with this table. So for instance, if we look at number one, stationary masonry saws, it states that if you use a saw equipped with an integrated water delivery system that continuously feeds water to the blade, and you operate and maintain that tool in accordance with the manufacturer's instructions to minimize dust emissions, you are not required under the standard to wear respiratory protection. You don't have to do monitoring. You don't have to make your own exposure assessment. You say, we are following that to the T, and this is what we're going to do. Do you see the advantage of fitting that? Now, what do you think happens if you can't do that integrated water delivery system with continuously feeding? You got to test the air. And then if it's over, you're required to use respiratory protection. And then you also have to do quarterly monitoring of that task in that condition. So it will infinitely get more complicated if you can't do what it says on the table.
And I wonder, is there a monitor, air monitor that's going to detect the silica?
Yes. Yes. And we'll go into that a little bit later. Did you want to add something, Art?
Mm-hmm. Then you'd have to go from there, or if you're limited to obviously having water there.
Right.
So that would be the only 2 hours.
And if you flip all the way past table one, there is a part where it explains what to do if you can't comply with those engineering controls. And it basically says, you got to go do monitoring, you have to do an exposure assessment, you have to then start doing lots of monitoring, and you have to start implementing respiratory protection. So we want to try as much as possible to be doing table one. Okay? And it also points out whether you're doing them in enclosed or indoors or in enclosed areas with exhausted dust versus outdoors or enclosed areas. And then it also has detailed information about the amount of water and then whether or not you're in an enclosed cab or not in an enclosed cab. So they will have different recommendations based off of several different contingencies that might take place. So for some of this is a pretty expansive list in terms of those 18 job tasks that they chose. They will say, if you're doing X indoors, you have to have these items. If you're doing it outdoors, you have to have these items. And then there are some situations in table one where they give you a couple alternatives. So it's X, Y, and Z or A, B, and C. But when they have those lists, and an example would be, let me find a good example. Number nine, a vehicle-mounted drilling rig. You have to do everything on one part or everything on the other part. You can't pick select items in each of those recommendations. Or number 10 for jackhammers. where it says you can use a tool with a water delivery system that supplies continuous water, and then it has the two conditions, or you have to do all three of those items. Use a tool equipped with a shroud and dust collection system, and operate and maintain the tool according to instructions, and the dust collector must provide airflow recommended by the manufacturer with a 99% or greater efficiency. So it's not like you're going to pick one of those items from the list. It's everything in one part or everything in the other part. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Is that like the N95?
Great question. So his question was, when in table one, they don't tell you what type of respirator to use. They say it has to have an APF 10. And so APF stands for assigned protection factor. And that is the number that NIOSH assigns to a respirator based off of the amount of exposure they expect that respirator could withstand before failing on an employee. And so if you need an APF of 10, that includes an N95, and it also includes a half mask, elastomeric one. So both of them would be okay. Both a half mask respirator and an N95 have the same assigned protection factor, believe it or not. Yes, Daniel.
I've seen a lot of concrete and masonry specific for dealing with concrete only, but as we all know, concrete is found in the drywall world all the time too.
So it's pretty complex when we start getting into more specific auxiliary, like the other tasks that might occur on a job site. And so much of this refers to concrete, but they do have data in some of the preamble and in the chapter documents that are referenced in the preamble related to drywall. And so that is something that we could incorporate in the class in greater detail. These are the tools or tasks. If it's not on table one, their expectation is that you are either going to have historical data to pull from to show that there is low level exposure below the action level, or you're going to do monitoring yourself and determine the levels are below the action level. So for situations, I know one of the areas that we're going to, groups that we're going to be meeting with are the terrazzo group. And that is a kind of fuzzy area where there's low level, potentially very low level of exposure, and most of it's encapsulated in a way that makes it the silica not as harmful because it's used in liquid form. And so helping them sort of wade through the process. We could theoretically go down a slippery slope with silica because silica is everywhere. And so we could say that almost any task in the world could somehow have potential silica exposure given the...
You can't say it does.
It does.
No, there is no... You could say that it does.
Correct. I mean, somebody reading a paper.
Do you live on a dirt road?
So there are a lot of very complex situations and industries in particular that are grappling with compliance of the standard. And we'll get into how we propose offering the services through Georgia Tech to assist with that. But we're going to put challenges, concern. You said... Yes, there are non-harmful forms of silica. In fact, you have to kind of be cautious. Apparently, quite the trend right now is to do this drink with what contains a lot of silica, but not in the harmful respirable crystal and silica, and I was talking about the silica standard to a group of people who had just done the cleanse, and they all freaked out because they thought they had all drank this toxic killing drink, but it was in a form that was not harmful.
All the N95 and the half mask,
Mm-hmm. Do
both of those require the respiratory fit test? And
great question. And the answer is yes. Both of them do if it's required. As soon as you say it's required, the entire respiratory protection standard is in effect. Correct. It's like that now, but there has been not as much focus. Okay, so a compliance officer right now most likely is not going to be nitpicking on all of that. They're going to be looking at the construction safety hazards, but there are going to be compliance officers now that are going to come out and be looking at crystalline silica, respirable crystalline silica, and then you're going to have to show that you're in compliance with both the medical side for the silica standard and the respiratory protection standard. And those are two separate items, entities. And you have to think of them mostly separately, because there is going to be this Venn diagram where you're going to have some people that aren't going to have to go into the medical surveillance program, but they're going to have to be part of the respiratory protection program. And then you're going to have some people that are going to have to be in both. And we'll go through that. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I talked about more than 4 hours. If the task is not listed, or if you're not doing the controls that are listed on table one, then you have to do the following. The PEL becomes 50 micrograms per cubic meter, which is a tiny, tiny amount. The action level becomes 25 micrograms per cubic meter. And then you have to conduct an exposure assessment. And so that includes either performance or scheduled monitoring. And the performance option means that you're going to be drawing from either historical data or on data that you guys collect as an industry and share. So I know y'all are competitive, but if you worked together, you could divide and conquer for some of the performance option tasks and say, using this tool under these conditions has this exposure, and go from there. So I do want to throw it out there. I know that is something kind of, you know, if you have associations that could start pulling that data, it could help to alleviate you from the scheduled monitoring option. However, if you're over the action level, that scheduled monitoring option comes into effect. So if you're below the action level, no further testing is required. If you're above the action level but less than the PEL, it's every 6 months. And if you're over the PEL, you have to do testing every 3 months. That is a lot of air monitoring for construction sites to be managing. And I will be perfectly honest, as a free service that our consultation program offers, we can come out and do initial monitoring. We might be able to come out and do reevaluation if you implement engineering controls, but our program is not designed to do quarterly monitoring for companies. And so that will require hiring somebody to be doing that aspect. And then this is a tricky part. If you do air monitoring, the employees are supposed to be notified within 5 working days of the results being received. And they also have to include not just that you're over the PEL, but that the company is going to be pursuing certain actions to try to achieve being below the PEL. So they're saying you can't just say, oh, well, we're over the PEL, we're just going to do monitoring every 3 months. You have to also be saying what you're going to do to make it better. And so you want to comply by doing engineering and work practice controls. And then if the controls and work practice controls are not sufficient, you must use them and then supplement with additional respiratory protection. So you can't just say, well, that control didn't work to get us below the PEL, so let's rip it off, just go full-blown dust mode, and just put people in respirators. You still have to try to use as much control as possible and then supplement with respiratory protection. All right, so what's required with respiratory protection? You may be required to use respiratory protection based off of table one. So that is one area where you may be checking, yes, we have to now have a respiratory protection program because the standard says, even with all the controls, respiratory protection is required. So if you are using a handheld power saw and you are using a saw with integrated water delivery system, this is number two, and you're operating it within accordance of the manufacturer's instructions, but you're using it indoors, you are required to have respiratory protection, even with the engineering controls. And we can attest that we have done air monitoring in situations like this, and the exposures still exceed the limit. So I want to assure you that they are not being ridiculous by saying you're doing the engineering control and you also have to wear respiratory protection, because the hazard does exist. We have done air monitoring to show that that happens.
So in a case, if you're using this handheld saw, you have to use water with it no matter what?
Yes.
And if you're indoors, that's not always easy to do.
That is correct. Correct.
Inside.
Correct.
What happens if you can't use water?
Then you have to do the either performance option or the scheduled monitoring option. That is not what we're recommending at all. Can we strike that from the conversation? So that said, if you do anything that requires it on table one, or if you're not on table one and you determine that the employees need to be required to wear respiratory protection, or you're in a situation where you cannot fully implement the engineering controls on table one, then you're automatically required to go into respiratory protection while you're investigating engineering controls. Yes. So that may either mean you go without and you figure out how you're going to comply from that perspective, or you find a way to do it outside and then transport it inside. And I'm not telling you how to do your job, but I'm also saying that it may be less challenging from a compliance standard to do it one way than the other way. So, okay, everybody take a deep breath. No dry sweeping or dry brushing with silica, and no use of compressed air. Or leaf blowers.
Are you saying no leaf blowers, no nothing?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So let's look in the standard where it says it, so you know I'm not making this up. Everybody take a deep breath. It's on page 19, okay? Just say cleanliness is next to godliness, okay, everybody? We are going to be very happy that this is going to be such a clean work environment, okay? The employer shall not allow dry sweeping or dry brushing where the activities could contribute to exposure to crystalline silica unless you are wet sweeping. That means you're adding something to make it wet. You're using a HEPA-filtered vacuuming system or other method that minimizes the likelihood of exposure. No compressed air to clean off clothing or surfaces, because that would contribute to the person breathing in the crystalline silica while they're using it. And so no alternative method is feasible. So when you would look at that, you compressed air can only be used in conjunction if you're using a ventilation system that effectively captures the dust, and you can prove that you can't use a vacuum system. If there is a vacuuming system attached to it.
Is this for indoors only? Or?
Period.
Just for example, your formwork guys cleaning off your columns and everything before it pours, and then most time they use air to blow the rebar and you can't. So that, but it's outdoors, is that?
It does not specify indoors or outdoors for housekeeping. However, that said, we have not read the compliance directive. So there is no specification whether it's indoors or outdoors in the standard itself related to housekeeping. Using dry sweeping outside is going to create levels of silica exposure above the PEL. So just be aware that I expect that they're going to say indoors, outdoors, it doesn't matter. I think with sweeping compound, we're hoping that they explain that in the directive.
When does the directive come out?
When they publish it.
Do you have any idea when that's going to come out?
No.
Well, the crane standard went along.
So they're going to start implementing this next year in June, but we have no idea when they're going to
do it. We are waiting for the compliance directive. And once we have the compliance directive, we will be able to provide more strategic, specific advice as to compliance with the standard. But from what I mean, this is kind of cut and dry.
I understand it, but basically all this reads then is it could be this, it might be this, there's not.
I don't necessarily think that's true, because I don't think that there's much, I don't think that they're going to.
The compliance directive, what I'm trying to get at.
Yeah.
Well, this is the final law, right?
Then why do we need a directive? I'm confused on what.
A directive provides.
One thing I don't expect that they'll likely change, because the whole goal is to prevent re-entrainment of dust into the air. And so if you've got settled dust and all you're doing is blowing it around, whether
I don't mean specifically about no compressed air, about so many things.
No, these are the law. The compliance directive, what it'll add to it, is clarification on how an OSHA compliance officer would come out and what direction they are supposed to proceed with the inspection. So these are all laws, but sometimes when it comes to industrial hygiene standards, it will specify more direction in terms of how to do sampling, and then under what serious level that citation would be. So this may be other than serious, but then they may say it's serious. Art, you wanted to add something?
So any of these OSHA rules are always subject to letters of interpretation, to people bringing up issues, people writing into OSHA and asking for
clarification.
I think this standard has been in the works for probably longer than the careers of some of you all in here, the younger folks. It's been 96.
At the AIA
solicitation, right.
They have thousands and thousands and thousands of pages of ammunition if there is the attempt to strike out any portion or to create more. The challenge with the sweeping, the dry sweeping, is some of those materials, I think, contain silica themselves. So, I mean, it's like adding a hazard to the hazard. So you may end up having to write letters for interpretation of specific products that may or may not be used. And in here it says that the sweeping needs to be wet. But that is something that we can certainly look to see if there's any data already in the preamble related to...
Like on sweeping compounds?
Yeah.
There's not.
I didn't think there was, but we'll double check. And so these are the visual things that an OSHA compliance officer would be able to see and observe while walking through a job site very easily. And I think these are going to be the low-hanging fruit in terms of citations, because it's very easy to see the employee blowing themselves down and see the dust cloud. I'm just kind of like, I envision, you know, seeing the work being done is one thing, but then seeing the cleanup at the end of the day being handled improperly will create the visual that'll make it hard to disprove that it happened that way.
Good question, Matt.
Yes.
And you may probably cover this. So with the housekeeping and everything, the recommended HEPA-VAX and a lot of this stuff, is there anything here for disposal of once it's collected in the vacuum? And what do we do then? The guy's probably going to fill it out in the dumpster, beat off with the filter.
You know, I have seen people dump stuff into the dumpster, and pretty sure that exceeds exposure limits for the day.
Well, I'm saying, once we've collected it in the vats from there, is there a kind of like asbestos? Is there going to be a disposal process?
No. No. Silica is not going to have to be disposed of as a hazardous waste.
But I think there is the expectation that you're like, if there's a liner in that vat,
yes,
that then you're taking that vat.
Well, so yeah, you've got to clean it back out.
It's not like you're going to be exposed
once
again. Yeah, you don't want to just dump it.
Yeah.
Beat the filter off against the side of the wall, like most people.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah, so that it's looking for those back systems that have the
self-cleaning.
It will all wrap, you know, sort of automatically clean the filter. Yeah.
But, yes, Art?
I think another thing to remember is that the standard exposure limit is 8 hours long. Okay, if you were 8 hours long,
yeah,
dumping the bags out of your vacuum, that would be a problem. But if it takes you, you know, 15 minutes to do it, and OSHA cites you for that, I think you just go to your lawyer and say, prove
we were over.
That
because OSHA has to, if they do air monitoring, they have to, for the time frame that they're not doing air monitoring for that employee, input zero exposure for the remainder of the day. So when they do air monitoring, they figure out the time-weighted average based off of the period that they do sampling, plus factoring in zero for the remainder of the day, just as an awareness level. Okay, so then the other area where we see a lot of concern, and we actually met last week with some of the health providers, the occupational health providers, because they are going to have a hard time, and we are searching to make sure that they can provide this portion of it, is that if you have an employee that is expected to wear a respirator 30 or more days a year with exposure to silica, in reference to exposure to silica, they need to be included in a medical surveillance program. And that medical surveillance program will be conducted initially and then every 3 years. The initial exam is going to include a chest x-ray. That chest x-ray has to be examined by a NIOSH B reader. That is a special certification. That means that your occupational health provider most likely will be sending the x-rays out to somebody who can do that and do that reading. And then there is also a detailed medical and occupational health history that needs to be taken, a physical exam, spirometry testing, and has to be done by a spirometry tech that has NIOSH certification, and that they also have to have TB screening. So a word on the TB meaning tuberculosis. The reason why they have us and have tuberculosis screening as part of this standard is because the exposure to silica makes an individual much more susceptible to acquiring tuberculosis. And exposure to tuberculosis makes an individual exposed to silica much greater to develop silicosis. So what that means is if you have an employee who is carrying tuberculosis and then you're exposing them to silica dust, the likelihood of them getting an occupational disease of silicosis is going to be much greater. The screening aspect is to prevent the spread of that disease. It's incredibly important from a public health perspective because of resistance to the antibiotics that are used and the medications that are used to treat tuberculosis. That portion, just to finish that statement, all you are doing is screening for tuberculosis. You are not, as an employer, required to do any follow-up related to that or any treatment related to that. That is all the job of the local health department that would be contacted as a result of a positive test result. Okay, so you are not actually going to receive the results for the tuberculosis screening. That is a screening. Then the occupational health provider is going to have to notify the appropriate health department, and then the health department is going to have to find that employee and interview them and then proceed with additional testing, treatment, all of that. So what I recommend from your perspective is to stay. Don't get so caught up in that requirement, but to stay, know that it's happening, but not to get too involved with the complexity of that issue. Because if you do, you're opening yourself up to a lot more information, and as an employer, you are not going to be receiving that information, and that's less information that you have to deal with. Do you understand? So be aware. These tests need to be conducted every 3 years, and the intent of the standard is that the results of these tests will be within the ownership of that employee, so that your employees go to all different contractors all the time, right? They are not necessarily the employee of solely you for 10 years. They may go, I'm talking about the guy operating the tool. So ultimately, the idea is that these employees will come to you with their pre-qualifications of the medical tests eventually. If they get it done one place, they can say that they've had it done and show it the documentation to another employer. We don't want employees to have 15 chest x-rays done a year because they move from contractor to contractor. That is not healthy for their bodies. So that is something that I think the licensed healthcare providers are going to be grappling with the portability of the results for these documents, because we don't want people getting unnecessary radiation exposure or being sent, or even the cost incurred from doing those tests over and over and over again unnecessarily. This is important to be talking to your temp agencies or the agencies where you are getting your workers from, because this is something that you're going to have to know whether the people that are showing up are going to have some form of coverage related to this. You guys are all going out for a drink after this, aren't you?
So we're going to look for a new job.
Okay. What you need to do really, though, and truly and honestly, I have seen citations lately of employers who have sent their employees out for medical tests and the medical providers that they're using aren't doing the right tests. And it has to do with maybe the person answering the phone is not doing it. So I've seen people who have had lead tests done that only get part of the lead test and not the full spectrum of testing that needs to be done related to the blood leads. And they end up with citations. So please, 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 when you send your employees out for their medical surveillance, provide a copy of the standard. You're required to send that to your licensed healthcare provider. Provide them, you are required, this is very specific in the standard, to tell them what the former, current, and anticipated duties of this employee will be. It doesn't say how specific you have to do, but you have to somehow quantify to that healthcare provider what that guy's going to be doing and how much they're going to be exposed to silica. And then what personal protective equipment is going to be used, because you want to make sure that that person is capable of wearing that PPE. Because if they have latent TB or they have early signs of silicosis, you don't want them having to be wearing a respirator, because they could have subsequent health issues, stress on their heart, hypertension, a lot of other things that come with stressing the lungs as a result of that, and then any previous medical exams. What happens is and there are sample forms in the appendices of the standard, which I did not provide, but you can download it off of the Silica page website. The healthcare provider is going to be providing different information to the employer, you, or the employee. So the employee is going to get full detailed results of what their health is, the condition of their health, whereas you are going to get basically a fit for work report. And that's what you want. You don't want all of their detailed information. You don't want to have all their health information, but what you want to know is whether they're fit. That said, the standard doesn't prevent you from having a talk with your healthcare provider and saying, hey, I don't want an employee to be approved to wear a respirator if they're showing signs or symptoms of exposure to X, Y, and Z. Because you don't want your healthcare provider providing blanket approvals to work if they're not healthy enough to be working. Does that make sense? This is where having really good conversations with the doctors providing the exams is really important, because you want to be clear that when you get that sheet of paper that says they're fit to do the job, that they are fit to do the job, and that the doctor took the time to do all of those tests that you just paid for, right? You want to make sure you're getting your full extent of what you're expecting. And the medical doctor also has the ability and is promoted to send an employee to a specialist with if they see that they need to. And I'm not going to get into the specifics of that, but there is a medical surveillance appendix that goes with this standard, and it goes into the different health effects of exposure to silica, the kidney disorders that can be covered, The lung disorders, whether it's acute silicosis, chronic silicosis, the degree to which you're exposed, and then it tells what specific specialists that employee would need to see to treat that person appropriately. Employees that are exposed to silica exposure have to receive silica-specific HAZCOM training. And in the standard, it highlights that you must address the hazards of cancer, lung, immune system, and kidneys. So you cannot just focus on the respirable effects. You have to hit on the other body systems that will be affected by exposure to silica. It's
so you kind of show proof of training is what you're saying.
Right.
Specifically to the SDS.
Mm-hmm. And this is what we're seeing more and more is the standard specifically states in there, employees must be able to demonstrate knowledge and understanding. So what does that mean? That means I'm a compliance officer. If I was, I am not a compliance officer. Let me just clarify that. I pull Joe aside and say, hey, do you understand silica? And he says, it's just dust. And the silica guy and the compliance officer says, obviously, the HAZCOM training was not effective. Documentation of the training is going to be appropriate and necessary, but there are also other elements of having that understanding.
Is this something you just be in the general contract? Could just be added into the employee orientation as long as they understood, or does this need to actually be training?
So there's two elements of that. You need to have it in initially and when conditions change, so that's the requirement with hazard communication. But you also need to be doing these little 15-minute briefings before they do the tasks to re-emphasize that they don't take the controls off the tools that they're using and re-emphasize why they are doing it in the first place.
So as it applies as a GC, how I would approach it, I briefly touch about it, but I'm not going to go into just ensure that JAH
And what we think is going to be one of those areas, and this would come in the compliance directive. The compliance directive would not determine, the compliance directive would prompt the compliance officer on where to focus on the aspect of training. And what we think that they might be telling them to ask about is the identity of the competent person. So you would want your employees to know, today you're going to talk to Sam. And Sam's the guy you ask with any questions. I mean, when you think about it, do the crane operators know who is competent? Do crane operators know who's the competent person is?
Yeah, they know if they've got a competent rigging person or flagging person.
Okay.
Well, they should.
They should.
Qualified.
Qualified. Okay. So they're going to be looking at it from a similar perspective. They are going to be saying, who's the competent person on site? Or who's the competent person you would contact with questions? There is no specific requirement as to there's no official card, okay? There's no official card that you would be getting, but you would have to show that you have had the appropriate training.
When in doubt, card it out. That's kind of what I'm
Yes.
I see there's an action level, and we talked about it. I walked it in the There's a PL.
No stell. Just an action, that would really throw a ringer in it if they had a stell, because that would get to the I'm dumping out my vacuum at the end of the day. So air monitoring records, again, this is why you want to be on table one and not having to do air monitoring. You have to have the date the samples were taken, the tasks monitored, sampling, and analytical methods. And to clarify, we just spent a whole lot of money purchasing pumps with a higher flow rate and new cyclones. So not to get too geeky on you guys, but the cyclones that we were using only had a limit of detection because they only could pull enough air through them that wouldn't have gotten us to the action level necessarily, especially for shorter exposure samples. With the door oliver or the cyclones that are normally used on a job site, if you've seen air sampling take place, it would require us to do a full 8-hour sample. So now we have new cyclones that can be sampled at a higher flow rate with pumps that can handle that higher flow rate. So sampling can be done. I know I've spoken to a couple people that are like, well, I heard on the street that you can't even do the sampling. That's incorrect. You can. It just requires the right equipment. And it's equipment that most people probably did not previously own. It does not specify that only, it does not specify in the standard that only a certified industrial hygienist can do the sampling. However, I will tell you, out of all the industrial hygiene sampling that we do, silica sampling is the most complex of every single contaminant I've ever sampled for. Would you agree? It's a pain. There's so many little things, like there's grit pots, there's cleaning, there's maintenance, there's storage, there's a lot to consider. And I don't necessarily think...
So if one of those variables are off...
Off, your samples will be off. Yes. It has to do with like how the person handles the tool while they're taking it apart and putting it back together. I mean, there have been vendors I've spoken to that said that they have videos to train people so that they can go out and do this type of sampling and rent the equipment. All I'm telling you is we have to retrain ourselves constantly to do this type of sampling because it is very complex. And the three of us are all certified industrial hygienists. So I would be cautious of having somebody on site unless they have the correct training doing it. Did you have another question? Okay. I am not trying to sell you on expensive sampling by any means, because we are always trying to get people out of having to do spending lots of money hiring consultants, but I'm afraid for industries to be able to question that data if it's not handled properly. It's a genuine concern. And if you do use objective data, you have to be able to make sure that the material that you did the sampling for or that was used is appropriate. So what that means is if you're providing sampling for drilling into bedrock in Atlanta, Georgia, you cannot compare that to results of drilling into bedrock in New Jersey, because the content of respirable crystal and silica is going to be different. So when you do use objective data, which is an option, however, something like sheetrock is the same no matter where you are, if you have the right brand. Yeah, unless it's from China, but it would be much easier to prove that similar versus something else. Okay, and then the objective data, did that get darker on you guys? I don't know what happened. Did that work? Okay. And the objective data equals air monitoring data from industry surveys. So that's where I'm getting to. If you guys could compile together and say, we do these tasks that aren't on table one, could we prove that these tasks do not put us over the action level as a group? Because that's the kind of data that you want to be compiling. So this gets us to more of the workshop section of the class. So that is a brief overview of the standard. We are offering, these are the first ones we have set up of the silica class that we're going to offer. It's going to be a full day class Our intent is to give you the required hour-long training on the health effects of silica exposure. It is going to cover in much greater detail how to comply with the standard, and then it's also going to help you wade through the complexities of medical surveillance, air monitoring, and respiratory protection. Yes.
Real quick though, the medical surveillance really only deals with if you have a person who will be exposed
30 days or more.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're just drilling holes every day, it's not really, you know, they'll have to. That's what I'm saying. If you drill one hole in concrete, whatever, you're going to have your
respirator.
Correct. And everything. So if there's a chance that you're going to do that, you know, 30 times in a year, That would mean that.
Correct.
So, I mean, that's almost all of us in the mechanical industry.
Correct. And that's where you would want to be. I mean, that is where we want to know what industries are going to have the greatest concerns, so we can sit down with them and have meaningful discussions on the complexities of compliance in those specific areas. Okay? No, that is.
Plumbing and mechanical is just, I mean.
And they have. Yeah, they have additional objective data in the, not in the preamble, but in the chapters that there are these chapters, and I know I keep referring to them, and I can send you links if you email me, that have information about plumbing that might provide you with the objective data that you need to provide.
Yeah, I mean, that's where I would say, the only thing I would add there is to go back to table one, right? And if you're performing drilling,
mm-hmm.
that's on there, all right, and you're doing it in accordance with the way it's specified in that table, and it doesn't say that any respiratory protection is required,
right.
because you're using a HEPA-assisted drill, then you're not needing to use
then,
respiratory protection.
Then they would be part of the respirator program, but not part of the medical surveillance with silica, because the silica standard would not be the reason why they're wearing the respirator. You would just have to be able to write that out in a way that you could defend if somebody asked you. Did you want to add something, Art?
Well, it's similar to what Hillary was saying. If you wear a respirator because you are required to by this standard,
mm-hmm.
that means that you're not required to wear a respirator until you are overexposed. So just drilled a hole and said, well, I think I'd like to put a respirator on because I just, you know, prefer to be more protected. That was not required by the standard, so that doesn't trigger one of those 30 days a year.
So if he was using just a standard hammer drill with no vacuum system or whatever,
If you are not in compliance with what the table says, then we're in a different ballgame. So that is where so this is a rough draft, okay? So everybody please, I should have printed it with a big draft over it because there's already one mistake, but I threw this together for you guys to be sort of your basic where do we go from here to-do list. So the first thing is you have to determine the applicability of the standard. So just what we're talking to you about. So we need to find out, does the standard even apply? So
can I ask, yeah. As I was brainstorming about this, I'm sorry, I'm just standing here with my kid, but he's coming along.
He's cute, so it helps.
In a class setting, if you're coming to gain the skills that you need to be identified as a competent person on your site, would it be helpful for you to have time during class to brainstorm specifically and list out, here's what I do, here are my tasks, here's the jobs that we perform on site, and then be able to take those and look at the standard in a class setting with someone to help tease out whether or not certain sections apply to you or not? I mean, do you want to be able to come and just be talked at, or would you want time to be able to sit and say, okay, here's what we actually do, here are the tools that we use, here are the tasks that we perform regularly, irregularly, and when is this going to apply to us and
there's different.
I see one head saying yes. Yes, sir.
Well, I just think if there's different components with the GC versus us as a sub,
sure.
I think that the same class really, I mean, you get, just like today, we're getting general knowledge, but.
So we could break out and separate you?
Yeah,
do some breakouts.
Yeah, that, you know, that you're drilling with, you know, the GC is doing, you know, like you said, boring in the granite and everything to do that, or saw cutting with the masonry guys versus the plumbers and the
Well,
HVAC.
And the questions that they need to ask their subcontractors,
yeah.
right? What documentation you are looking for from subcontractors,
yeah.
right? And, you know, maybe you're not self-performing any tasks, but you are going to be responsible as the GC for looking at some of these things that your subs are bringing to the table. Yes, sir.
I think what he was saying, what I'm hearing is if you don't fall within the 30 days for wearing a respirator or you don't get the PL.
Action level.
Action level.
Mm-hmm.
Then if you've got an employee that's doing a task that wants to wear a respirator on a voluntary use, does the standard specify voluntary use, or do you just go back to the respiratory standard, and so you have to meet that part of the respiratory standard that applies to that individual that work activity that they're doing on the voluntary basis?
Okay, so that's a there's a lot of different layers to that. So his question was, what if an employee wants to voluntarily wear a respirator? So this is where your competent person would come into play and your exposure control plan would come into play, because that exposure control plan would already designate when this task is done according to these specifications, respirator use is not required. Then you should also have your incompetent person be saying, however, if an employee chooses to wear a respirator on a voluntary basis, then X, Y, and Z needs to be done. For voluntary use of respirators of an N95 filtering face piece dust mask, all you need to have is them to read and understand the aspects of what's called Appendix D of the respirator standard. As soon as they're required to have a respirator, you could also have the caveat where the competent person says, this person is performing this task in accordance with the Silica standard. According to the Silica standard, respiratory protection is not required. However, our company policy is the employee is going to be required to wear a respirator for added protection, not in relation to the Silica standard. Then you would not be doing the medical eval related to the Silica standard. But then you would have to do all the elements of a respirator program. And that would include the written program, the fit testing, and the medical eval for respirators. So that's lots of different things. But what I'm hearing from you guys is that it would be helpful if maybe the morning had the content you needed to know, and then the afternoon you guys could break out into workshops based off of area of work or type of industry, and maybe develop your plans or approach in concert with a leader that would be kind of facilitating that working. Okay, well, we're thinking about sort of how to frame the class to be most useful for you guys, because we don't want to have you all in a class and have you have different concerns.
Mm-hmm. There are various disciplines of their subcontractor DC or whatever they do, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But also give them a task, each one of them different tasks,
mm-hmm.
i.e. List questions, this group. You know, come up with some challenges and concerns, or I don't know, instead of saying, okay, develop a plan.
Right. Well, what we're working on right now is we're working on a spreadsheet where you would just be checking boxes for each thing that would kind of be a decision tree on where you would go. So we're hoping to make it interactive enough that you would be guided through that process. And definitely we're not going to give you complete free rein. That could be dangerous, right? Okay. As a reminder, and then I'm going to go, to continue with this checklist, I do want to point out that number five, it says when you're above the PEL, but it should say action level. So that one was incorrect. The idea is that you're going to go through this checklist and you're going to say, okay, does the standard apply? Can I stick to table one? And then for each task that's on table one, am I using the appropriate engineering controls yet? And so you're going to ask yourself, do I need to call a vendor or a manufacturer to start purchasing the new equipment? The new equipment's going to be cheaper than hiring an IH to do quarterly monitoring. So I'm just saying you could do a price analysis, and that's going to be, I can venture to say that it'll be cheaper to do buy the right equipment. And the equipment vendors are very excited to. Then you have to ask yourself, are there any additional dust control or water suppression systems that you need to ensure that you don't have any exposure? So is there anything like dumping of the units or vacuum systems to clean up at the end of the day from a housekeeping perspective that you might need to choose? Table one should guide you through that process. The next thing I want you guys to do, and this is where the consultation program can come in to a limited degree, is saying, is there anything on that list that's not on table one that we're doing? As a rule, we have chosen that we are not going to do any sampling for tasks that are listed on table one. The reason is it complicates things unnecessarily. If it's listed on table one, the law is already telling you what to do. You don't need to have additional data telling you otherwise, or that it contradicts, or that it doesn't apply and now all of a sudden you still have to wear a respirator. It doesn't matter. Table one is law. So we are not going to be doing any monitoring for tasks as listed on table one through the consultation program. Yes.
The silica rule is already in place, correct?
The silica rule has already been signed. We are not going to have something like the ergonomic standard where it disappeared after a change of administration. Okay. I know I've heard some people saying, well, maybe if we just wait till after November, it might all disappear. Not going to happen. Okay? I've listened. I listen a lot more than I talk, believe it or not. So, and we teach a lot of those classes, so we listen to you guys when you're having the water cooler talk at the break area.
With all the IHs that the OSHA has hired and everything, this is probably going to really be right down their alley.
So correct, since they keep advertising that they're looking to hire additional industrial hygienists. Yes. Yes.
The way I understand it, if you're not in compliance with table one and you don't perform testing for work that's related to issues that create silica,
it's not voluntary anymore.
You can't volunteer. The only way you can volunteer is if your testing comes up below the quantity, then the individual has the right to volunteer.
Yes, exactly. If you're not in full compliance with the standard, you have to wear respiratory protection. It is only voluntary if you're doing everything that standard tells you to do. The table says respiratory protection is not required. Then you can start introducing voluntary use. Or if you did a task that's not listed on table one, you did air monitoring, it was below the action level, you're not overexposed, and then the employee's like, well, I would just prefer to wear a respirator. So after you determine that, then we can create a list of all the tasks you do that aren't one of those 18 items on table one. Because those are the ones we want to start compiling objective data to show that they are not on table one, but the exposures are X, Y, and Z. And those are the ones that we will, as much as possible, be assisting companies with doing air monitoring for. We already scheduled air monitoring for October 10th, so that date's booked. Like, I have people scheduling me in October now. Just FYI. Like, we are having people come to us to do the monitoring. So we do have a free on-site compliance assistance program. This program is limited to small businesses, less than 250 employees. We provide, we do go out to about 365 companies every year. And we identify conditions. It's a carrot and a stick program. So when we identify conditions, you're required to correct them. But it is a cost savings because we are estimating how much we prevent in terms of injuries and illnesses. And we know that it being a free service, you guys have a tremendous opportunity to take advantage of it. And we can go through, but you can request a limited scope visit related to just specific monitoring if the task you're doing, and we can assist you on a one-on-one basis with the development of a program. You get a confidential report from us. We identify all the hazards we see in that report. We reference the standards in that report so you know why we're making that. We also suggest recommendations, and we can do follow-up sites if you do make changes. So let's say you were using one type of tool, you bought a different type of tool, and now you want to prove that you're no longer over a limit, but you've made improvements. So that is one situation where we can come back out. We only focus on hazards as related to OSHA regulatory text, so we typically don't go into areas that are not covered by OSHA. We won't write the programs for you, so we'll provide guidance. We'll assist you in the thought process, but I will not sit at your desk and be your private safety and health rep for your company. I know.
On the clock.
And we don't cover non-OSHA related things. So we don't address mold or indoor air quality, personal testing like audiometric testing. Our state, we can't cover any state or local employees. And if you're a self-employed small contractor, we can't cover you either because you're not covered by OSHA. And the carrot and the stick is that as long as you correct all the hazards we identify, we will close the file and seal it, and we shred them after 5 years. If you don't correct the hazards, we do reserve the right to contact OSHA. We don't like doing that. We've only done that less than a handful of times in the past 35 years that we've had the grant. So we do our best to not make that referral. And we identify the hazards in line with what OSHA would recommend. So they're either serious, other than serious, or regulatory, which follows the same framework that OSHA would do. And we do offer these limited service visits, which is what would apply for you guys in terms of the silica monitoring. And that is my contact information, but I do want to just kind of go over this checklist a little bit more with you guys. After you do the tasks and decide what's not on table one that you guys are doing and that you have to start figuring out whether or not you need to do air monitoring, I want you to start. That's where we're going to have to start talking to each other and determining whether or not there is historical data that is valid, which is going to be the challenge because some of the data will not have reached the detection limit necessary for the act to reach the action level. And that's a complex issue that I can go into greater detail about later, but you have to see if there's any objective data that says you're safe. So that's where we would look to see if anybody installing sheetrock, we can say without a doubt it's not hazardous. And then what you need to do as your next step is you need to go into determination mode. So then you have to determine what type of respiratory protection you're going to be doling out, because again, unlike other standards, respiratory protection is going to be the determinant of whether or not you're doing medical surveillance, as opposed to the air monitoring results determining whether or not you're doing medical surveillance. So you're going to have to quantify what the exposures are going to be. You have to figure out how long they're going to be doing the tasks on a day-to-day basis. That 4 hours is going to come into play. And then you're going to determine the location and usage of equipment. So this is where the indoors, outdoors, enclosed cab, non-enclosed cab is going to come into play. And then you have to see, is your determination of respiratory protection already predetermined? Because some tasks, even with engineering controls, you're going to be required to do respiratory protection. And then I want you to be thinking about it from two perspectives. So then you're going to have to implement the respirator program. The respirator program has to be implemented before you put a person into a respirator. That is the intent of the respirator standard. The medical surveillance gives you 30 days from beginning of the task to do the medical surveillance. So those are two different tests. You could have the medical provider be doing the medical surveillance for silica at the same time as the respirator, but please do not be putting your employees on job sites without the respirator fit tests or documentation of that, because that's considered to have to be done from day one. And then the housekeeping requirements of the standard, I included a checklist so you can start gauging whether or not you're complying with that portion. And then the development of a written exposure control plan, I listed out the individual tasks and ideas and concepts you need to cover in that program. So you need to list out the tasks in the workplace. You need to have a section that describes the engineering controls and practices. You have to also have a section related to housekeeping and restriction of access. The program is going to need to be reviewed annually, so you're going to have some way pre-set up into it that you're going to be reviewing it regularly. And the program has to be readily available to the employees on site. So I know that's going to be challenging for people in remote locations, etc., but that is going to have to be something accessible. And that is something that will be clarified in the compliance directive, is what is their definition of accessible.
So it's basically your company's information you're talking about here should really be in your site-specific safety plan.
Correct.
It's on the job site.
So the job site-specific safety program, consider them like a safety data sheet. I should be able to assess it. Correct. And then I included a table with the requirements for how many competent persons that OSHA projects you to have based off of the preamble. And then I didn't include a lot of detailed information about the medical surveillance program, but there is a very detailed appendices of the standard that goes through step by step every test in great detail that licensed healthcare provider needs to be performing. So this guides you to that information. Really important for communication of respirable crystalline silica is they are requiring you to assess labels and SDSs. So this means, and my interpretation is that you're going to have to start labeling things if they contain silica, like your HEPA vacs. And that is something that we will be tracking how they approach that. But it is addressed in the standard, and that what topics need to be covered that OSHA would consider necessary for them to demonstrate knowledge. And then I included the record keeping requirements. And then the final page is that all requirements of this standard are going to commence June 23rd, 2017. We could have a party that day.
Unless they push it back like it's been cringe day.
I don't expect that to happen. Do you guys have any questions? I used my entire hour and a half.
We appreciate it. You said the doctor reading the x-ray had to be a notch.
B-reader. There are not many of them. If you want to get a new job, go become a B-reader.
What did you say about the person doing the exam itself, the physical exam?
They can be... they have to be a licensed healthcare provider with knowledge of occupational health issues. So they call that a PLHCP.
Okay, I saw it on this list.
Yeah.
It said that, okay. Thanks.
So that's in your standard. They detail that in the standard. But the other thing is that this person performing the spirometry has to have a special certification as well. And that's typical. So that's not something you're going to have a challenge finding. But these are things that you want to make sure that they're doing so that people don't challenge the results. I had more questions, yes.
The medical surveillance part that you were talking about?
Mm-hmm.
That's not.
That's not in there. That was a lot of pages. It is on the OSHA website. And when you go, if you search OSHA and Silica, and you go to the new standard page on the right-hand side, there is the construction standard in a PDF, and then there's the appendix for the medical surveillance. And it is a very comprehensive document that will go through step by step.
Is it possible to get a copy of your slide presentation today because you broke it out a little bit easier than the actual slide?
Please send me an email and we'll send you a PDF of the presentation slides. Any other questions?
You said the odds were greater for somebody with TB
mm-hmm.
to get silicosis.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a number with that? 50%, 75%?
There are numbers, and I am at the end of lecturing all week long, so my brain is not accessing those numbers. But it does describe that in the appendix. Maybe let me see if I can bring that up, because I know where I have that on my computer. This is one where, honestly, I'm very proud of them for taking the approach of addressing a public health issue, because it will serve everybody. It will benefit everybody. So this is what the medical surveillance guidelines looks like, and it has an introduction. And then it has detailed information on how to recognize silicosis disease. And this is for you to send to your licensed healthcare provider, because then they will be able to know. I mean, doctors should get this training in medical school, but it may have been many years since they've been in medical school, and they probably don't get this training. And so they need to freshen up on what to be looking for. And this details the biology of all of that. And so, here's one place. Okay, so here it says, in addition to silicosis, dang it. I've forgotten I'm being recorded and I'm shouting, dang it. Okay, so it says here, employees exposed are at an increased risk of contracting active TB and other infections. I'm not sure where they have that data. I think it's in the preamble.
Where they actually pull those scenarios out.
Yeah.
And they give the citation. And so if you went to the article,
you could find that.
What the increased risk is.
It's significant enough that it's irrefutable in terms of biology and the science behind it. I don't know if 50%. It's statistically significant. Let's say that much. It's enough that they can say that it is a huge impact. But I will add that to our list of making sure we have that data for you. Stats. But just in case you're wondering, I called the state health department and they weren't aware that this was part of a standard. So, I mean, from that perspective, it's not... It is going to be a challenge to see how they handle if there are a bunch of new cases that are identified. They're excited. As soon as I told them, they were thrilled, because the challenge with TB is that if it goes untreated and people aren't treated properly, this is one of those areas that is really making us at risk of medications no longer working for other illnesses. So we don't want people having TB and not getting it treated, because the resistance in it is becoming really dangerous. So it is without a doubt a good thing from a humanity perspective. Okay, keep reminding yourself that we are part of a humanity. And from a humanity perspective, it's a good thing. Okay, any other questions? It's Friday. Thank you very much.